That way you don't have to look behind you. You can see what you're reading in front of you. Did it start?
Give it 10 seconds.
10 seconds, then you can start. You see, you got everybody here for the most part? Good enough. All right, red light. All right, welcome to day 2, everybody. Almost there. Whenever you're ready.
I like shrimp. Do you like shrimp?
Yeah.
Well, apparently, guess what? Lionfish does too. Oops, wrong photo. This lionfish. Also known as Praetorius volantis. This you see here is an invasive species, which means a species that is expanding so rapidly and for no good either. It is causing more harm than good. Here is some background information about this little creature. Lionfish have distinctive brown or maroon and white stripes or bands covering the head and body. They have fleshy tentacles above their eyes and below the mouth, fan-like pectoral fins, long separated dorsal spines. An adult lionfish can grow as large as 18 inches, while babies may be as small as 1 inch or less. They have been known to live in many different habitats, but they usually prefer to stay in the depths more often amongst the rocky coral reefs. Native to the warm tropical waters of the South Pacific, Indian Ocean, and the Red Sea, these little creatures made quite progress migrating and swimming. Eventually they ended up in the native coral reef ecosystems, which is here. Specifically in the Atlantic, the Caribbean, and the entire Gulf of Mexico. And yes, they're damaging these areas quite severely. Interactions. Now first, about coral reefs. Coral reefs and lionfish have an indirect relationship that both participate in very critical roles to help each other survive. For example, lionfish usually eat herbivores, and herbivores usually eat the algae that grows on coral reefs. Due to the fact lionfish eat a lot of reef herbivores, that algae growth does not fit the healthy standards for the reef, and can sometimes cause reef destruction. However, other than the coral reef, the lionfish also has several other organisms that it interacts with, especially some of the native species of the Caribbean reefs. According to the study, lionfish can cause effects on native species, and those effects wear off of them as you can see changes in their consumption. This can mean in terms of space or food. In detail, lionfish reduce their shelter use in the presence of spiny lobsters and long spiny sea urchins. And these two are both native species of the Caribbean reef. They all coexist and share the same shelter day and night. Spiny lobsters are rarely consumed by lionfish, and the long spiny sea urchin has a very important role in macroalgal grazing, which means grazing on the rocks and kelp that is visible to an eye. Other interactions include, of course, the lionfish's predators and prey. And towards human, they tend to hide in further reefs due to numerous lionfish colony programs. Or for predators, there aren't really any natural predators, but most likely sharks, eels, grouper, and snappers. For prey, lionfish will eat anything from more than 70 marine fish and invertebrate species, including yellowtail snapper, and also grouper, parrotfish, banded coral shrimp, and more. With venomous spines, lionfish have few natural predators in their native habitat, and none in the Atlantic and Caribbean region. So why are they considered invasive? Well, first of all, they can reproduce very quickly. Lionfish can multiply quickly. A single female spawns more than 2 million eggs per year. And also, they can live in many multiple coastal habitats, including coral reefs, mangroves, and depths ranging from close to shore to more than 300 meters, and they're very adaptable to their environment. Also, they harm their environment very much, because lionfish, they can also not only harm the coral reefs, they also harm the diversity of fish. So lionfish have been spotted at depths up to 300 feet below the surface. This high density of lionfish has resulted in the decline of herbivores, fish, and sponges, causing algae growth to dominate the reef. A study from Blockwall from the year 2003, when lionfish first began moving to the region, to 2009, was performed by observing the structure of the coral reef ecosystem. By the end of the study, it was concluded that percent algae cover at 46 meters was 27% in 2003, 31% in 2005, and 94% in 2009, demonstrating the impact that lionfish had on the reef since their arrival. There are many damages done to the economy that lionfish has a role in, including where the region where they live. The lionfish invasion could have serious socio-economic implications. Commercial and subsistence fisheries may suffer losses as lionfish either prey on economically important species, such as snapper or grouper, or compete with those species for food. Lionfish could even impact the Caribbean's 2.1 billion, billion dive tourism industry, as they have the potential to greatly reduce the diversity and the attraction of the reef ecosystem. Divers, swimmers, and fishermen also risk of being stung by this venomous lionfish. Lionfish has often been proven to increase from 23% to nearly 40% of the total biomass of predators, which demonstrates the rapid rate of decline in native species. An example of smaller fish preyed upon a lionfish is a critically endangered fish known as a social morse, which is a pressure board that is one of the five coral reef species in immediate danger of extinction. Hypothesis. If we remove them from their current area of invasion, we could see less microalgae on their reef. So why is this so important? Why do we care about coral reefs anyways? Well, first of all, they protect coastlines from erosion and storms, which is very important because millions of houses could be lost and could be damaged. Also, it's a very big, important habitat for many marine life, just like a very big ecosystem. It's a source of food and important attraction. Without it, can harm the tourist industry, as I just said, which is worth billions of dollars. So this is what people do today. This is their very humane way of how to get rid of this. And we do not want, can we imagine if we were them? Like, we don't want this to grow up our bodies. So here's what, and then these are why I don't think this is the best way, because you can be likely stung by poisonous glands. It's very inefficient because they learn to adapt by going underneath the depths of the ocean to avoid human interaction. And also they also learn to avoid humans from this. So how are we going to do it? After a lot of brainstorming, this is how the process will look like. So basically, it's a... imagine a ball, and because female lionfish and male lionfish are attracted by mating, and how they mate is basically they will look for lots of dorsal fins and animals that look like them. So I plan to make a ball attached to a metal wire or a metal long rod with the same, like to look like them, to make it look like them, so they will be attracted by it. Then we have a button that can expand inside the machinery to make it like turn into a net that can capture them, as shown from here. And it's kind of like an umbrella method, but it's going to be very efficient, because basically we don't need divers to go and physically catch it, and it'll be like extendable, so it'll be quick and easy and humane without hurting them and pulling them through. So this test will be at the John Kent Coral Reef Camp, because after the map from UCGS, this area has been noted as one of the most dominated lionfish areas, and around the Key Largo area. So this street I researched, they're open for, they're selling for $1 million, and it's an open street right to the harbor of Key Largo, Florida 325 12th Street lot. And basically I can move the fish easily over here, transport it since it's right in the harbor to this, and build a mini conservatory over here. It will be all funded by the reef camp, and because they have, their tourist attraction is very important, and they're worth like billions of dollars, so I think it'll be good to, we can both help each other. Conclusion, they're invasive demons, can lead to coral destruction and less diversity in fish and marine life, can harm our economy in not only the tourist industry ways, but also, they can also harm like our food and also our shelter, and shelter is also part of the economy, so we don't want that. And should be immediately taken care of in a humane and efficient way. And also how I decide to measure the microalgae growth is when once the lionfish are put into place inside the conservatory morning glass tanks, we will then label each of the coral reefs, making sure we can keep track of each one, and we will label those in a 2-mile radius. So we can start small, so we know our range for now. And we can keep track of those ones by the microalgae production by hiring climatologists, data scientists, and conservators monthly to check on them. We will put buoys that are attached to the seafloor on the edge of the 2-mile radius, making sure we know our range. And that's how exactly we're going to measure the microalgae. And that's my conclusion, and that's my sources. Thank you.
When it senses a fish, how will it know that it's a lionfish?
Because I was going to use AI and artificial intelligence. So basically, like, there's going to be sensors there. So we will teach the machine. For example, if you teach them, you can teach a machine to recognize a certain sort of species, right? So for example, you can get like a species of lionfish and you show them in front of them, and they will recognize a memory after memory, and they will note that that's a lionfish. So next time another fish comes nearby, then it will know that it's not a lionfish. So it won't release the next. Female in one tank or male in one tank. Basically, I'm going to, because they're going to fight over territory, right? So they're just going to kill each other. Like, that's the best way to naturally.
Isn't that less advantageous?
Like? But it's better than, it's more efficient. Also, let things run naturally, you know what I mean? It's better than getting a stick right through them, I feel like. Because after you cull a lionfish, basically, how it works is that they have like this long rod and you like hit it and then like it goes right through them. So once that happens, it's still alive because the lionfish is not completely dead. You're just scorching through their body. Any other questions? Yes?
How many lionfish are there? Can you catch all of them or just try to control the number or get rid of them?
I think that right now we should start small, but the good thing about this thing is that you can settle multiple areas. I'm focusing on one area right now that has the most dominated right now, but if you want to expand, like completely eradicate the whole thing, these plots can be easily, like, you can just set multiple boats and just have a lot of the these models out there, and then they catch a lot. Yes?
Can you go back to your hypothesis slide for me real quick?
Okay.
I just wanted to see what you said again. Okay, cool. Less macroalgae on the coral reefs. Wonderful.
Yes, so is your plan to destroy the whole species of by conserving the final immature plant cells, or are you trying to reduce the number of them?
I want to reduce the number because remember, as I said, they eat herbivores that eat off algae. We need the perfect amount of macroalgae. We cannot have too much or too little. So we want to reduce the numbers because right now they're eating too much of the herbivores that eat off the healthy algae. So right now we need to make sure that they're in stable numbers instead of eating too much. Yes?
Do lionfish have a certain mating season? Because if you do it to attract the males, if they're not in season, will they still come to the trap?
Lionfish, they mate throughout the year. Like, they don't have a certain thing, because, they have some seasons that are probably, more, frequent of mating, but they'll definitely, mate, every day.
Okay, thank you.
Yes?
With the devices that are supposed to look like the lionfish to attract them?
Yeah, because, let me show you. This thing. So I have 18 dorsal fins because that's what they have, right? And then they have the stripes, the white and maroon stripes, and then they have the head. And then, it will attract, as I said here, this is the right model for it. The fish will come to the,
What are the chances that the lionfish will actually come to these contraptions?
I mean, that's the only way they usually mate. Other than they don't have a mating call, so the only thing is by vision, how they see. Yeah. Any questions?
You said they'll fight for the territory, so will they really concentrate in one area?
Basically, because I'm going to put them in a small tank, and they're going to fight, and they won't really concentrate because they want the whole area. Not really whole area, but they're in a small space, and they want that small space already because they already have a limited shelter area, you know what I mean?
All right, I'm gonna have to cut the questions there so we can get to our next presentation. Ava, thank you very much. Very well done. Thank you.
So hi everyone, I'm Liz
basically powerful enough microbes. And this is their ass, and this is their early stage and late stage. And they become adult, and they're flying when they're rest. So this is map that they're like recently using basic right now. Like for America, like we can see for like the places like Eurasians and India, those kind of places are invasive to like the most like harvest and adjustment. And so we can know like even in Pennsylvania, like it is the invasive law. And in worldwide, like place like South Korea, like America, and those kind of places are invasive law. And for their invasive, so invasive please. So explain why we call spotted mandarin as an invasive species. It's because they have a stinging mouthpiece to feed on those plants, for example. And they will obtain like their nutrients through that. And because they get all of those nutrients and sugars in them, but they cannot digest all of them. So they will like excrete an excess substance called like honeydew, and the honeydew will hurt the plants, and the honeydew will also like attract the other insects that is in interest to like sugar. So they will also hurt the plants and spotted lanternfly. And this picture is how spotted lanternfly. And that is the ants, like leaves on the tree. So for the way that we can reduce invasive right now, the first one is sticky band, like the first picture. So we use a sticky band and put them on the tree, and we use a thing called mesh net on it. Because sticky band, it's not only like get spotted lanternfly, it will also get the other stuff, the other like creatures. So if we put a net on it, it will really good at prevent those birds to get stuck on the bed and just fine. And the second way is trap. So trap, it is like a thing to use our tree. Like we put them on the tree and we the spotted lanternfly which you eat. And when they cross through the tree, so they will get into the trap and they will be caught. But this way is not really good for use of those patterns like trees. Because probably they will go through the bulbous and they will still get to eat and destroy the tree. So the third way is trap injection beds. So those professional groups used to like give shots for those plants, and they can really good at prevent spotted lanternfly and it can hurt the plants. But the problem with this method is it really requires a lot of like professional equipment and research to use them. And the fourth way is kill agent. It can only deal with the ants with other plants. But it will also hurt the plants. Although it's not a lot, but it will hurt like a little bit of the plants. And the last is I think everyone should like check before you leave. They really like stay on some cars or some like trees when you transfer. So it will move some of the lanternfly to another place. And they will visit here, so that is that. So how can we deal with those things? So I think there's it's very good that we can do. So I wrote like five species that spotted lanternfly really likes to visit. The first one is big trees, and the second one is mango trees. The third one is black fungus. The third one is the fifth one, the first one is rich trees, and the fifth one is blue trees. So, we take like six of them, and we separate them, like into two groups. We don't need them to at the same area. We can just separate them at two groups. And each group would market them, and one group would use those best, but I mentioned before. And one of them, we don't use them. But as I said, there's some like disadvantage with those methods. So we can use those methods at like certain species. For example, like for bridges, like it is really smooth on the tree. So spotted lanternfly is not easy to get into there. So we can use the machine I should like at the second picture. So the spotted lanternfly, when they go to eat, they won't cross through the rows so that they can get caught. And so like for this one, like it's a tree with a lot of growth. So we can use probably a sticky bed and we put on there and it will work. So for sticky bed, we can use it like in some areas that not contains a lot of like endangered species. So it will work really well and cause a lot of like water. And for the result, for my hypothesis, like I think we will catch like a lot of spotted lanternfly in certain areas and with those methods, and it will like reduce a lot. So for my like expectation is they can get like so for the first group that use method, the 4 of 5 is not going to hurt. And 4 of 5 of them is not going to hurt. And so that we can clear the 2 of the groups. And I hope the first groups is not hurt that much. And for summary, I think spotted lanternfly is really good at invasion. And they're like really good at them. And they always feed on some big moments that are important. Like great beans, like markers, like worms, those things. It's difficult to completely kill them. So every time we go out, we need to check them. Like, if my car has those, has what the lanternflies say out here, those things. And so far, it's really hard to find a method that can really like deal with every plant and to help them to prevent and kill the species.
I've got a question for you real quick. Could you just really quickly for me just cycle through with the slides again, if you don't mind? Okay, thank you.
Anybody else have questions, or should I ask?
So you talked about how they hurt some plants and trees. Do they hurt our, like, is their invasiveness detrimental to other, like, insects or animals or those kind of creatures?
You mean
that they can also, like, kill? Yeah, does spotted lanternfly, like, detrimentally affect more than just trees?
Like,
other living things?
Yeah, so for example, like, the green things, like, it's not accepted like trees. But we can still use those methods. For that one, I think we're really good at, but I think we can use, like, sticky net. Because it still has some growths on it, and if we use sticky net, and it will cause, like, a lot of, like spotted lanternfly, and will hurt the others. And that will work also. But for those, like, small plants, do not have a really, like, big group. We can, like,
Thank you, Lindsay. Wonderful. Devon, ready?
Cool.
Whenever you're ready, yep.
As competing with deer and squirrels while
course, predators, well, more of the natural ones, but of course, larger carnivores may eat them, like mountain lions, possums, and humans can, of course, be considered a threat. A few animals that more would have to worry about being a food source for are actually at risk for contracting diseases or parasites from the board. With the ability to carry at least 30 viral and bacterial diseases and 40 parasites, they can contract diseases like E. coli, tuberculosis, and many other diseases. Because of this, there's no top down control to naturally rate the population numbers, and there's also no bottom up control since, again, the more outcompete most animals and eat everything. These facts being a contribution to why they're considered to be invasive, since they're able to adapt so easily to most environments, migrating to places they haven't been introduced to. As well as this creature, these creatures are sexually mature at 6 months, and females can typically have around 3 litters with 10 babies each a year. A study addressed that this species possesses the highest reproductive potential of any large mammal in North America, and they currently inhabit so many areas in such immense numbers that it adversely affects the entire ecosystem. Causing a drop in biodiversity in ecosystems, they're not native to. Predation on species, pest predation, habitat alteration, competitive displacement, and disease transmission all diminish biodiversity. The wild boar has played a role in the decline of at least 300 plants and animal species in the U.S., with over 250 of them being already endangered or threatened, like the Houston toad, hides, emerald dragonfly, Hawaiian boar, and pink toad. National Geographic has said that ecosystems that both have invaded are a quarter less biologically diverse than before they inhabited. This graph shows the quantity of taxa, which are like groups of animals, that are affected in regions where wild boar are prevalent. This graphic shows regions of the U.S. that inhabit wild boar in coordination to threatened and endangered species susceptible to further decline. As you can see, you can have in ecologically sensitive areas, because once they become immersed and thrive in an environment, which they will reproduce prolifically, and it is very difficult to reverse the biological damage they cause as well as get rid of them. There are primary threats to numerous endangered species of animals and plants. Once a species is gone, there is nothing. If there were a decline in wild boar, then biodiversity would increase. These creatures are extremely detrimental to places they don't belong to, which makes extermination seem like such an awkward battle, pushing us humans into a corner and stuff it, turning to unnecessary methods to take care of this issue. Most wildlife professionals are shown to use aerial shooting as an easy solution to decrease the boar population, which they call pork choppering. The use of toxicant is another recently popular and again easy option. Warfarin is an antiquated drug that has been approved by the Environmental Protection Agency to be administered due to extreme cases of overpopulation. Now, we could use either of these methods, and it will prove to be effective. It gets rid of the problem, wildlife. But what these methods have in common is also the reason I would use to propose either of them. They are lethal. This is a global crisis, and so in many regions, in Europe especially, slaughter, even humanely, is an approach that is not publicly approved. These would be wasteful deaths. And although these animals are antagonized, their only intention is to survive. So when they eat harvest crops, the boar can understand it affects their livelihood. They can't control the disease they contract or transmit, and they don't know if the Houston toad ate is the last of its kind. Survival of the fittest is the only one. So these methods are unnecessary, especially when there is an alternative method that is much more suited for such a concerning case. Lethal methods are assumed for small numbers, but based on the invasion curve, as you can see, this is a short-term attempt at a solution. I understand that this problem may seem overwhelming, so turning to an easy choice is not good, but that doesn't make it the sustainable way. What I present is fertility control, a long-term plan to limit the population of invasive boar. Eradication at this point is not possible, so trying to control the current population to prevent further ecological decline is the best course of action. It will have mitigating effects because statistically we cannot kill more boar at a faster rate than they reproduce while they are at this number. By stopping the supply, there will be a reduction in population, allowing the natural course of life to dial back the numbers, slowly allowing the ecosystem to return to what it once was before the invasion. First, we must identify and focus in on areas densely populated, like riversides and forest edges in Texas or Florida. Next, pre-baiting will allow the boars to become more accustomed to the bait and higher chances of coming successful. Cannel cord will be used as bait, and to ensure that no other species like deer will be lured and trapped. each dose of this will be measured to the individual female based on weight, the toxin load of the animal, and its cost efficient. The dose will be intramuscularly injected with a hypodermic needle into a large muscle mass that they will find for their neck, and the bore will be tagged and then sent. The results would mirror that of the same application vaccine done on white children. Of course, the effectiveness depends on the species, but testing done by the USDA proves that the idea is certainly doable and just as effective as the use of Dronicon on the deer, where it had prevented 78% of pregnancies within the first year. This graph is from the deer study, which shows the progesterone levels and antibodies created after Dronicon was administered, and then it goes through by the higher the levels, the better, and so as you can see, the water results. But this has been used on wild horses, squirrels, prairie dogs, elk, kangaroo, goats, feral cattle, all of which have been proven to be highly effective. Long-term use of Dronicon on large populations of wild boar will prove to stabilize and eventually reduce the size and range of them, and in turn balance the native ecosystems. With the boar slowly but surely decreasing, natural restoration will occur to destroyed or overrun regions, and endangered or threatened animals like the beasts of the will have undisturbed bird and rats and nest. It will no longer be disproportionate competition for food. Vegetation being rooted will again flourish in our native lands and all wildlife, livestock, and animals in our ecosystem. We can undo the damages that they have caused and restore the ecosystems to the natural order and right the wrongs we as humans have made by introducing this highly invasive species to all parts of the world where they did not belong. In closing, wild boar are highly invasive, and the magnitude of their destruction causes decline in biodiversity to other species and vegetation. In turn, we must stop the increase of their population by administering the cost to halt fertility and let the natural factors reduce the numbers. Thank you.
Excellent. We have time for one question. Who wants to ask it? Nobody? I'm going to be honest, I don't have any. I think you nailed everything. I don't have anything to ask you. You explained everything. Does anybody have anything they want to ask?
Have you ever seen a wild boar?
No.
They're scary.
Yeah.
I used to watch a show on Animal Planet where they would hunt them down and they're big.
Yeah.
I would not want to mess with one, that's for sure. All right, excellent job. Jesse, ready? Awesome.
Food, the Our density specifically in Melbourne are reported to be as high as 16 per kilometer square compared to the densities generally less than 2 per kilometer square in most semi-arid grazing areas. And I believe if we don't take action on it, the situation will get worse for other species. Obviously, the Australian government sees the sovereignty. So in Western Australia, the fox is declared pest under the Biosecurity and Agriculture Management Act 2007, administered by the Department of Primary Industries and Regional Development. This is declared for the whole of states in the Management Control Category C, the Prohibition Keeping Category. And it is absolutely not fair to see red fox in Sydney, Australia. I would like to call those foxes our red foxes because they are generally found in immense washland or parks. Foxes can find refuge in the railway platform, houses, sheds, and in the quiet gardens. Washland areas in and around cities provide an ideal shelter for them. In urban areas, foxes eat a diversity of food types, including small birds, worms, insects, fruits, and cats, or other food put out by residents. Urban foxes will rarely attack people. However, foxes are wild animals and should be treated as such. So, distribution of urban foxes actually depends on the availability and distribution of suitable shelter and food. Now, I'm going to introduce my tab. This is a graph that shows that the population of cat, rabbits, and foxes under red fox were introduced to Australia in the 1970s. It is obvious that the red fox population got larger, and the rabbits and cats population were getting smaller. Based on this, and we talk about, I designed an experiment about how the fox affects its prey's population, such as rabbits. To begin, Taz, I made a hypothesis about it, which is the introduction of red fox to Australia affecting ecology and other species. For this task, I'm going to do it in Melbourne to see how harmful red foxes are to other local species. I will use a scientific way and also help from the government to report the population of red fox and rabbits that are during the experiment. After that, I will compare the number to population size before red fox were introduced. For the results of the experiment, it will really likely to be that the population of rabbits decrease as foxes increase significantly. It's pretty bad, isn't it? So what can we do to decrease the red fox population? The way I suggest is because the red fox were initially introduced for a hunting purpose, so the government should start to encourage people to hunt for fox again. That might be the less harmful way than spread disease for fox, because that could also hurt dogs at the same time. After you take action, expectantly, the rabbit's population size will increase back to the size before red fox has been introduced. As a conclusion, fox are really good invader and affects native species population and diversity. There will be no significant negative impact on removing them from this habitat. Yeah, that's all my presentation for today.
Does anybody else have any questions before I ask mine?
Did we? Go ahead.
You said that the amount of rabbits would increase back to its original. Do you think maybe that it increased more, or that how long did it happen? I think as long as people started to take action to hunt red foxes, I feel like rabbits, because it's really good at reproduction. So rabbits' population will
So how did they get there in the first place?
They get there for people to hunt. Like, that is kind of for people's interest.
Okay.
So they're
introduced by people. Interesting. Yeah. Wonderful. Could you go back to your hypothesis slide for me real quick? I was writing when you said it and I missed it. Thank you.
Yeah.
know some of the other presenters talked about eradicating invasive species in a humane way. Do you think that just encouraging people to hunt them and kill them, that there might be some pushback about that being inhumane?
I think that is the best way. I think it's only going to hurt or decrease the fox population instead of being affected the whole ecosystem. Because, as I mentioned, if we use disease, it will affect dogs or wolves habitat. So I feel like that's not really like a really good way. Like, people probably don't want to do that, but I think that would be the best way to decrease.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Jess. Oh, we have another question. Go ahead, Ava.
They like to, so they, you don't usually see them during the day, and they're almost everywhere in cities, like under the shelter or in parks, but like you don't really see them. So.
Excellent. All right, well, I've got to let you guys go. So thank you very much, Jesse. Thank you very much, everybody, today. We are coming along pretty well. You guys have done a great job so far. So thank you for putting so much effort into this. It makes me happy to see. All right, you're free to go. Have a good rest of your day. I will see you tomorrow. Please make